shutters down, income slashed, staff furloughed, or worse, let go altogether. That's the reality for hundreds of thousands of businesses in the food industry around the world. Many have struggled to stay afloat, forced to shut up shop altogether, while some have been forced to innovate to stay alive.
You know when you watch an action movie and it's in the middle of the night or something, and then one of the characters always say, let's stay here and hide. And then the other character says, it's either we move or we die. So you've got to move or die.
This week, we're checking in with some past food chain guests to find out how they've been coping during the pandemic. We'll hear how some have really suffered.
I pretty much haven't earned a penny. People are struggling to find money for food. The last thing they're thinking about is eating chocolate.
But they'll all tell us that they've found the resilience to keep going. And for some products, business has never been so good.
In the last 3.5 years of having this business, I don't know that we've ever sold more bread. Some areas, aspects of the business really dried up, but others really kind of took off.
My personal biggest fear was dying of corona. I wouldn't go to the supermarket because I had corona anxiety.
This is Hezron Lowe, co-founder of Something Fresh, a fried chicken restaurant and food truck fleet in Johannesburg, South Africa.
I actually lost a friend to corona, and he was buried last week. So I still have the anxiety.
Hezron's life has been turned upside down since we last spoke to him in early March for our episode about the fried chicken business, when he told us,
fried chicken is not just an easy meal. It's an experience. It's a lifestyle. It's a culture. If you meet somebody and they don't know what fried chicken is, you have to find out what is wrong with that person.
Well, you have to eat your hat.
Yeah.
Yes. It's a universal thing. It's so universal.
South Africa enforced some of the world's strictest lockdown measures when the country pulled up the shutters to contain the virus on March the 27th.
The government was very heavy-handed in terms of how they handled the lockdown. It was basically dealt with military precision. Like, you had to have a document to leave your home for any particular reason, except for going to the pharmacy or the supermarket. And there were a lot of, like, difficult things. Like, they banned the sale of cigarettes, the sale of alcohol, and this just put everyone into, like, panic buying mode.
Fortunately, Hezron's nightmares about contracting the virus haven't come true, but his business, like millions of others all over the world, hasn't escaped its effects.
Because we a restaurant, food truck, we were shut down immediately. There was a further ban on sale of hot foods, so even supermarkets couldn't sell hot foods like pies or roasted chicken. So you couldn't sell prepared food in any form or shape. And we were just shut down. We literally had no cash, you know, no money coming in. It was difficult. That's something we've built from scratch. We've had community support us, friends, family, neighbors, our customers love us. And we still get messages from them on Instagram, Facebook, saying, guys, miss you, love you, can't wait to get that chicken in my face. I feel like I'm getting thin because I'm not getting chicken. So stuff like that.
Hezron's business had some cash reserves, and he tells me he was able to get financial support from the government to stay afloat and keep his staff employed. But
what happens when lockdown opens or ends? Is there a job for me? So that was their main concern. And it's one of those things you just can't answer at this point. So at the moment, I don't know when the government's going to say, listen, you can open up again. I've got a lease I've got to pay. I've got insurance I've got to pay. Eventually the slush is going to run out for everyone.
But like a true entrepreneur, Hezron's trying not to let adversity get in his way.
You know when you watch an action movie and it's in the middle of the night or something, and then one of the characters always say, let's stay here and hide. And then the other character says, it's either we move or we die. So you've got to move or die, you know? So every day I'm thinking of a new thing to do. Because it's not that you knock on a door, the first door you knock on, they're going to be like, hey, come inside, you know? Here's the money, here's the business. No. The other day I sent 350 emails for a food truck event at Office Parks and stuff. I received one reply. And the reply was, we are currently closed. And if we do open, you cannot come onto our premises and feed our staff. Please don't email us again. Thank you. So it's one less email to send next week because I'll send another email, you know? So I think the main thing for entrepreneurship is that true entrepreneurs will survive. The spirit of entrepreneurship is someone who's willing to take a chance, willing to create an opportunity in a situation where people are hopeless.
Despite that spirit, there have been times when Hezron has found it really tough.
So the other day I was quite depressed, actually. I was like, oh, it's miserable. I was like, oh, my business is going to go down. Oh, I can't pay this bill. Oh, all those emails I sent. I was on the sofa like for 4 days. And on the fifth day, I'm like, I've got an idea. Let's do this celebrity thing.
This celebrity thing is the latest of Hezron's lockdown innovations.
And what we're going to do is we are going to say thank you to the brave people that worked during lockdown.
Hezron is planning to feed frontline workers and at the same time keep his kitchen going and his staff working. But he won't only be sending food.
So it's going to be really exciting. So we've got a bunch of celebrities on board and we're going to rock up at a petrol station, for example, and have a party with the petrol pump attendants because they were working there during lockdown. We're going to go to our police stations and people will be able to buy a meal or nominate a police station. And then we raise the funds for that police station and we go and we feed all the police officers on the day and, you know, no high-fiving. So we'll just be like, yay, woo, yeah, here's some chicken. You know, and you'd be surprised.
From 2 meters apart.
Yeah, 2 meters apart, you know, contactless delivery. But you'd be surprised how much people are going to appreciate that. And, you know, we want to make people feel normal again. Because that's what we need, feeling normal, feeling happy, feeling joyful.
While Hezron's fried chicken business has largely been put on hold, other food outlets around the world have been able to stay open throughout lockdown. And in Canada, business at one bakery has taken a surprising turn.
My name is Seth Gabriels. I co-own Autun Boulangerie in Montreal.
We first heard from Seth back in November on our episode, Bakers Earning a Crust, when he told us...
We do maybe 15 types of bread on a daily basis. We mill our own flour in-house. Whole grains and local is really the philosophy of our place. Our bakery is very much a neighborhood bakery. Our business is focused on the people within a 2 kilometer radius.
So when the lockdown began in Canada, it was no surprise Seth carried on baking.
Because bread is so ingrained into the culture of the Quebecois, we felt we had a duty to the community to stay open and to provide that place of comfort and to provide food. And so it really wasn't even a question for us. It never even crossed our minds to close the doors. The first few weeks were extremely stressful, only because my partner became sick almost immediately.
Wow.
And so he immediately went into quarantine for 2 weeks. He subsequently tested negative, but to navigate those waters with our staff on my own and my partner sort of working by telephone with me were very difficult, very stressful. Everything was so fluid. Things changed not on a day-to-day basis, but really on an hourly basis.
And of course, Montreal was the center of the pandemic in Canada.
Yeah, exactly. So there was definitely a high level of stress. And we made the decision this past year to really ramp up the business. And so we've hired quite a bit more staff and we've expanded our operations. So, you know, I'm not one prone to outwardly emotion, but the stress made me cry several times, just not knowing how to proceed and making decisions that, you know, are not only affecting myself, but my employees and my family. I have three kids. My employees' families, it really is, really was a situation I'm not eager to repeat.
But although Seth was able to stay open, demand for his products took a big hit when lockdown began.
So we had quite a significant restaurant sales or wholesale business beforehand that dried up overnight. So pretty much every restaurant in the city has closed. And slowly we've seen in the last 2 weeks, places are reopening. They're shifting towards a takeout business. So that business has slowly started to come back as restaurateurs and entrepreneurs are trying to adapt and find ways to stay viable and keep their businesses open. But from one day to the next, you know, that was a major hit for us for sure.
And the number of customers walking into his bakery dropped off sharply too. But gradually, his regulars have come back. And now he's selling more bread than ever.
We've added online sales now. So for example, people can order and pay for in advance and then just come in and pick up. So they no longer have to do the line, for example. And so that's helped sort of mitigate a lot of people's fears about going out shopping. But overall, I think that, you know, in the last 3.5 years of having this business, I don't know that we've ever sold more bread. So it's been, yeah, some areas, aspects of the business really dried up, but others really kind of took off.
And what about the breads you were making? Were there things that you could no longer make or things that customers wanted more of that you hadn't experienced before?
Yeah, for sure. The shopping, what people were interested in changed dramatically. So what we noticed immediately was where beforehand people would come in on a daily basis and buy a baguette or a loaf of bread for their dinner that evening. Now people were coming in and buying 10, 12, 15 loaves of bread at a time. So, you know, and that's one of the positives we found about this whole thing is that people were watching out for their parents, watching out for their elderly neighbors. But yes, it also changed the way that people bought because no longer was the focus on the weekend about having brunch with friends. It's just not possible. So people were buying loaves that lasted longer, are buying loaves that last longer, that freeze well, and tend to be a little more nourishing. So we've eliminated some of our breads that we maybe will put some ingredients like ginger or blueberries in just because they weren't, people were looking for more whole grain, more nourishing stuff, I think.
And he also spotted another opportunity with an ingredient which, unlike many supermarkets, he had plenty of: flour.
There actually wasn't a shortage of grain or wheat at all. And I think that was somewhat the advantage of using local farmers, was that I didn't have to rely on large supply chains with several middlemen. I deal directly with the farmer. So the farmers had plenty of grain. We mill our own flour in-house. So we haven't had a shortage at all. And in fact, it sort of opened up this whole new revenue stream for us because there's been a shortage in the grocery stores. We've we never sold flour before, but now we're bagging our own flour and selling it in the bakery. And it's a pretty interesting revenue stream. You know, the whole sort of worldwide movement to making sourdough at home has been kind of fun for us to see and to, you know, we've really appreciated the fact that many more people are interested in what we do on a daily basis.
Why do you think so many people have turned to baking?
I think it's just, you know, it's something that's so primordial, so important and integral into so many cultures and so many communities. Bread is such a comforting item. Regardless of how well the bread actually tastes, that smell of fresh baked bread in your house
is something. It always smells good.
It always smells good. So I think that was something that people could turn to that was comforting.
And do you think that will continue past lockdown?
I think for a little bit, for sure. I think that I think that just the time investment in making sourdough bread, it's just such a time constraint when you don't have that time, when life has returned back to normal and kids are back in school and people are back at work. It's not something I think that people can venture to on a daily basis. I think that the fact that people have tried and have a better understanding is a positive thing for us as bakeries, as people realize what it takes on a daily basis, and they have that much more appreciation. I saw a recent Instagram post from somebody who mentioned having tried to make croissants at home, and his comment was, "I don't understand why bakeries don't sell these for $1,000 a piece." Just because of the complicated nature. And so I think that it's been a positive in that sense for us as people, you know, get a better understanding of what we do on a daily basis.
While some foods, like baker Seth Gabriel's bread, have been needed more than ever during this pandemic, there are others that have been put back on the shelf.
Chocolate, the way I made it, was known as like a luxury item. Do you get it? So people are struggling to find money for food. The last thing they're thinking about is eating chocolate.
Ruth is the founder of Sweet Arts Company in Accra, Ghana. When we last spoke to her in December, she was making her artisanal chocolate for some of the most powerful people on the planet and doing it using the cocoa beans from her family's plantation.
I've had Prince Charles, and who else did I make for? I've made for Vladimir Putin. Can you imagine?
Wow.
Yeah, I know.
And did you see him eat your chocolate?
No, I didn't. I doubt he ate it, though. I'm sure he took it straight into the bin.
Ruth was absolutely at the height of her success, proving that Ghana can not only be one of the world's largest exporters of cocoa, but it can make premium chocolate too. 6 months later, though, she hasn't sold a single bar.
Literally, from the last work I did was on the 6th of March. I pretty much haven't earned a penny. We don't know if we're ever going to have our businesses back. It's just, it's all hazy. Like, there is no certainty in anything.
Ghana closed its borders in March. It meant many of Ruth's customers, African dignitaries and other world leaders visiting the country, stopped coming. Before the pandemic, business was going so well, she was about to open a new shop in one of Accra's most prestigious hotels, the Kempinski.
Literally, we were almost, I think, about 3 weeks away from opening when this happened. That's the worst thing that ever happened to me, because I'd sunk in a lot of money into it. The rent was super high because it's like, it's the biggest Kempinski in Ghana. It's like the biggest hotel in the country. And we had like, we're all excited to do like a nice launch party, and all of that's just gone to pots really, because nothing's happening. Couldn't open. We've had to put brown paper all over the glass and just shut it. It's been shut since March. And it's really sad because it's like, I can't get my money back. And at some point, I may have to even consider giving it up and not, you know, going forward, because I've lost a lot of money and I haven't recouped anything. It's really a hard time. Like, it's really hard. It's hard to even think about how hard it is. I actually went there a week ago. All the plants are dead. It's really sad, like, because it had so much life and so much potential, and to go there and see, and it felt so dreary and dead and like literally felt like a cemetery. It's rubbish. Like, and I don't even like the space anymore. You know, it's like, It's dead.
To make things harder, Ruth lost her mum to a heart attack at the beginning of the pandemic. The last few months have made her question whether she wants to stay in Ghana or move back to the UK where she's from.
I literally said, once my mum gets buried, I will be coming back to England to work for a bit, because it's the only place I know as well that I could get like casual work for a bit. So I'm thinking of coming back and just like doing a small like project or getting a project management gig or something like that, to just for about a few months, like 6 months or so. And then I can save up a bit and come back and see if I can kind of like do something else.
But Ghana's borders are still closed, so there are no flights in or out. Ruth isn't going anywhere yet, but she does have other plans.
I realized that a lot of people were eating a lot more food because they were home. So I was thinking, hold on, could that be that I could start a food business? So I went and got a little shack, well, a space, which I rented to start doing grills. So in the meantime, I can't believe this. So in the meantime, like, I'm starting to see if I could work towards that.
But that's what businesses are talking about, isn't it? The only way to survive is to innovate. So you're thinking of adapting your business and moving away from chocolate forever, or?
No, not forever, because obviously chocolate has what's gotten me where I am today. And chocolate is like my first love, really. So, and I can't, people won't let me move away from chocolate. I mean, everywhere I go in Ghana, someone's asking me, do I have chocolate in your bag? Like literally everywhere I go. Also, I don't have another job, so I have to make ends meet some other way. So I was thinking of making like fish and chips and stuff, like little things from all over the world. So I've got this little shack and I'm going to kind of introduce them to a few different foods, and hopefully that works. But I have all the faith in it.
So you've had so much to deal with over the last 3 months, but it does sound like you have got an element of positivity in the way that you're adapting, starting your street food idea.
Yeah, I'm naming it after my mum. So her name was Joyce, but her middle name was Carl. And so we made it Carl's Grill Box. She loved her food. So, so that's what I'm trying to do. But yeah, because I can't sit still.
Has any of this changed your attitude towards chocolate?
It's very important, but I've realised that I need to do more, you know? It's just doing chocolate is not enough. I got quite complacent thinking that I would always have a business because this chocolate thing had, you know, people were into it and people were buying it. And I thought that was it. But then I realized that I just had to do more and I need to keep reinventing myself. You know, when it just feels like you're just raining on your past glories and stuff. And I'm just like, you need to do more. There's so much more you can do, you know? So I'm not going to sit around and just wait and make chocolate the only thing, you know, that I'm doing.
That's all for this week. Please let us know what you think about the show. You can email thefoodchain@bbc.co.uk or get in touch with me on Twitter @Tamasin_Ford. And if you can spare a few minutes more, please do give us a rating or a review wherever you found this podcast, if you're able to. It really does help us spread the word about the show. From me and the rest of the team, Siobhan O'Connell and Simon Tulett, thanks for listening and join us again next week.